A very good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee for 2024. We have apologies from Katie Clark. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda item 3 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. So our next item is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's budget for 2024-25 with the Scottish Fiscal Commission. This is an opportunity to consider the Commission's forecast spending on devolved social security benefits and how this is reflected in the social security budget for 2024-25. So I welcome to the meeting Professor Graham Roy, Chair, Professor David Ulf, Commissioner, and Michael Davidson, Head of Social Security and Devolved Taxes. So thank you very much for accepting the committee's invitation. Before we move to questions, I'm going to invite Graham Roy to make some opening remarks. Thank you.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come along and speak with you this morning about our forecasts. Overall, we estimate that Scottish Government's total budget next year is set to increase by £1.3 billion from the latest figure for 23-24. That's a rise of 2.6% in cash terms, or 0.9% after accounting for inflation. Now, most of this increase in funding comes from income tax, a combination of the Scottish Government's policy choices, high inflation, fixed tax thresholds in cash terms, and relatively strong earnings growth in Scotland have all contributed to a sharp increase in income tax funding. However, the Scottish Government's spending commitments are also rising, with pressures from decisions to freeze council tax, increase public sector pay, as well as our forecasts of increased spending on social security. We forecast social security spending will rise from £6.3 billion in 24-25 to £8 billion in 28-29. This is largely a result of payment rates being uprated by inflation and higher spending on disability payments, which reflects both a UK-wide increase in the number of people receiving disability payments and the effects of the Scottish Government's policy and operational changes to disability payments. We estimate that Social Security spending will be almost £1.1 billion more than the Social Security BGA, so the block grant adjustment, funding the Scottish Government will receive in 24-25, with the gap rising to £1.5 billion in 28-29. Now, this gap is a result of Scottish Government choices in Social Security in the budget and in previous budget decisions. And that includes things like the introduction of new payments, such as the Scottish Child Payment, and also the new approach to implementing Social Security benefits, such as Adult Disability Payment. Now, these choices are designed to deliver a new approach to Social Security in Scotland, but they do have consequences for the Scottish Government's budget and also future budgets, as we highlight in our report. We are grateful to Social Security Scotland for the statistics they have published on Scottish Child Payment and the new disability payments, as well as their ongoing insights and intelligence gathering which they share. In particular, the statistics on adult disability payment have allowed us to begin to evaluate the assumptions and the effect of the changes introduced by the Scottish Government on the overall budget. So far, there's no clear evidence from the data that we need to adjust our judgments on the level of successful applications or the average award level. However, we have modified our assumption around special rules for terminal illness as a result of there being fewer cases than we had forecast. And we'll continue to monitor the data from Social Security Scotland and refine our forecast as necessary. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much, Professor Roy. I'm going to come in now with some questions, and the first one is, so much of the cost of uprating is covered by the block grant adjustment, as you indicated there. To what extent does this year's uprating policy put pressure onto Scottish Government budget choices?
It's a really good question, and one of the things that we talk about in the report is the effects of uprating and inflation. So essentially, with high inflation, the key benefits get uprated by a higher number. And we have a box in our report, box 5.1, which show you that increase. And the total effects of uprating by the end of the period are about £1 billion. It's essentially coming through adjustments for higher inflation. But as your first part of your question mentioned, This is essentially uprating that happens similarly across the UK as a whole. So the block grant adjustment essentially protects a significant amount of that increased expenditure through leading to, through coming from higher funding. So we talk about, as a rough kind of rule of thumb, we think about 85% of that increase in uprating is matched by an equivalent block grant adjustment. And the remaining kind of 15% essentially is not covered by the BGA. So that essentially is where you would see the pressure coming through in terms of the Scottish budget. I guess early on, 15% is a relatively small number of increases, but as you clearly get to the end of the forecast period, that number gets chunkier and bigger.
Okay, thanks very much. Professor Ulf, would you like to come in on that? Thanks.
Yeah, I just want to make an additional point here that when you're uprating benefits for inflation, there is both a cumulative and a compounding effect of that uprating. So if, for example, you uprate for inflation by 10% in year one and by 6% in year two, that means that benefits in year two, or spending on benefits in year two, will not be 16% higher, it will be 16.6% higher than it otherwise would have done, because you're uprating the first year's inflation by the second year's inflation. So long periods of persistent inflation can add up to very significant amounts of uprating in the future. So that's why our forecasts further out for the effects of inflation tend to be very large. It's not just there's large inflation further out, it's the cumulative and compounding effect of earlier years of inflation that are driving that.
Okay. I guess my next question then is, how uncertain are the inflation forecasts?
It's another really good question. There's a lot of uncertainty about the outlook for inflation, at least over the short to medium term. So the first thing I would say is that over the longer term, we can be pretty confident that inflation will move back to target of 2%. So by the end of the forecast horizon, you will have inflation much closer to the target. And the reason for that is that the Bank of England has a legal target to do that. So they will make it happen. But in the short to medium term, inflation is really uncertain to try and predict. And you see that, we talk about in our report about just the differences even in our forecasts over the last year about trying to predict inflation. For a couple of reasons. One is that a lot of the effects that we're seeing, or the variability we're seeing in inflation, are things far outside the control of this place, far outside the control of even the UK. It's global supply changes, it's pressures on energy prices, such as the war in Ukraine. These are the big drivers of what have been feeding through to inflation. And obviously, it's very uncertain to predict that, and you're trying to predict global events, so it's really quite difficult. So I think in the short to medium term, there is uncertainty about the outlook for inflation. Over the longer term, we can be much more confident that it will come back down towards target. The final point I would make, though, is coming back to the discussion, your first question, which is, to an extent, the BGA, the block grant adjustments, protect the Scottish budget from that uncertainty in inflation because the funding flows through from that. But clearly it's something which we have to monitor, and we update our forecasts as we go, as we get new inflation numbers.
Okay, I don't know if anyone else wants to come in.
I just want to add that when you're thinking about uncertainty about inflation, there's two different aspects of that. There's uncertainty about the level of inflation, but there's also uncertainty about the persistence of inflation. And the question is how far inflation is embedded in the system through wage demands and pay increases as well, which will tend to make it a more persistent level of inflation.
Okay, thank you very much. Ros McCall wants to come in with a supplementary question on that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful and very informative. The initial question was the uprating policy putting pressure onto the Scottish Government's budget choices. And we've been very much focused on inflation, which I understand. Is inflation the biggest concern when it comes to those pressures, or is it very much the variance of policy decisions of the Scottish Government? And can I have an idea as to what's the biggest concern? Thank you.
So there's a couple of things to say. So if there was no differences in policies, and essentially that everything was exactly the same as what was happening in the rest of the UK, then broadly speaking, the BGAs would then equivalent to how much spending was being made in Scotland. And the additional spending, so where the additional money needs to be found within the overall totality of the budget, essentially comes through the policy choices that the government make. And we talk about how that's the figure that rises. We estimate will rise to 1.5 billion at the end of the forecast horizon. And roughly about half of that is new or social securities that don't have social security spend. It doesn't have a block grant adjustment, so things like the Scottish Child Payment. And then about the other half of that is where we think that our judgments are that the different approach in Scotland is likely to lead to higher spending relative to the equivalent in the rest of the UK. And one final thing I should say about that, we talk about that as a spending pressure, and we talk about that as a gap from a public finance point of view. But it's clearly government decisions prioritising certain elements of spend over others. So it's just the nature of the funding means that there is a gap there, but it's just choices that the government is making.
Thank you.
Correct. In addition to the pressures coming from inflation, we're seeing pressures coming from the rate of application for benefits. So there's some interesting data coming out. There's UK-wide data that the level of inflows into particularly disability benefits is far higher than the level of outflows from that. So the number of people getting benefits is increasing quite rapidly across the UK, but also within Scotland as well.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks. Just continuing the question of inflation, I just wonder, I realise I'm also on the Finance Committee, so you might have answered this question before, but you said in your opening remarks, Professor Roy, that the cash increase for the whole Scottish budget was 2.6%, and that was a real increase of 0.9%, and the difference is 1.7%. I just wonder if you could explain that 1.7%, because we are putting up benefits by 6.7%, and maybe you can just confirm, is Westminster putting their benefits up 6.7% as well?
Yeah, so maybe, Michael, you want to maybe come in on some of the specifics, but I guess one thing I would say is when I'm talking there, I'm talking about the total budget. One of the big things that is driving the change in the total budget is what's happened to the capital budget, which is falling. So if you look at the resource budget, it's going up by more than the total budget. So there's a cash increase of about 3.3% on the revenue budget, so the resource budget, which is where Social Security is. The total budget is going up by less because capital budget is being cut significantly. We also have something else, just one other thing that might be quite helpful, Mr. Mason, as well, to see is we have a table in the document, which I'll try and find, but is that what happens to the total resource budget when we strip out Social Security and the non-domestic rates income? So essentially the remaining discretionary budget on resource, and you see that that's actually going down in real terms next year, which I think is the flip side of your question about what's happening to the total resource budget and then what's happened to Social Security within them. Yeah, so it's figure 2.7. You see that between 23-24 and 24-25, the real terms growth in the resource budget, taking out Social Security and non-domestic rates income, which are essentially commitments that have to be paid for, the resource budget is falling in real terms next year. And that's essentially the effect of this, of the squeeze on the overall budget of the commitments through in Social Security.
Right.
And yeah, I can just confirm just the point on the UK government's uprating in England and Wales is 6.7% as well as it is right in Scotland. So the same rates have been applied. So that's why much of the sort of increase in spending in Scotland is matched by the increase in block grant adjustment.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Happy New Year to you. You suggest that the cost of living crisis may be causing a short-term increase in applications for disability benefits across the UK. Can you explain further how this impacts occur and why would you consider this to be short-term?
Okay, so a couple of things I would say is, just building on David's point that he made about what we're seeing at a UK level is a really quite significant inflow of people into disability payments, and there's, you know, that we might come on to this, but it's linked to concerns about mental health and various other prevalence of disabilities coming through, and that's the big driver of the overall increase that we're seeing in adult disability payments, you know, over the last couple of years. That's matched by a BGA. Because it's a UK trend that we're seeing. One of the things that we then unpick within that is part of that overall increase, evidence that we're seeing the cost of living crisis potentially leading an uplift in people moving into claiming for these benefits. And that can be a variety of reasons. It could be because the cost of living crisis is increasing concerns around disability and mental health, so it's pushing people into difficult positions, so then they're more likely to claim these benefits. It also could be as if people are facing a difficult choice in terms of their household incomes. Are they more likely to take or to claim a benefit that's potentially higher than a benefit they might not otherwise otherwise claim? So you might see an increase in people moving into disability payments rather than, say, some of the other benefit, universal credit and job seekers and the things. So you get a potential more of an inflow into that. To that extent, then it's a potential that it can be short term. In the sense that it's a short-term decision that people are doing that. So we talk a bit about that, the OBR talk a bit potentially about that effect in there, and it's essentially a short-term kind of economic cycle effect. The one caveat I would put in there, though, is that once people move into certain disability payments or move into a certain aspect of the benefit system, they tend not to come out quite quickly. So there's a potential risk that if more people move into claiming certain benefits, then that can potentially lead to a longer effect, a longer tail effect of any short-term effect that might be coming through from the inflow into these disability payments.
Thanks for that.
Can I just elaborate on that point? So we're not talking about a short-term effect on caseloads. You know, what we're saying is the caseload may increase, but because as cost of living pressures ease, those pressures to apply for it will fall back a bit. So what the OBR talks about is caseload growth rates will be falling in the future as the cost of living crisis eases. It's not the level of the caseload that drops, it's the caseload growth rate that comes down in the future.
Thanks. So I was trying to kind of understand that, obviously, because we're talking about, you know, non-means-tested benefits. So I was kind of, you know, why that would kind of drive up the costs in a cost of living crisis, you know, the factor. So thanks for that. You also kind of indicate there's a take-up of disability benefits through the form of ADP will be higher in Scotland. What do you think the case is for that?
So we've always made assumption very early on, our judgment has been that the different approach to delivering disability payments within Scotland and the combination of factors on things like promotion of these payments, encouraging people to apply, and a different approach to how you engage with people, so a more supportive environment for people, more help in the applications, less interrogation of the various requirements that people have. That overall, quite a different approach to delivering Social Security, which is which is the entire purpose of what the government are trying to deliver in all of that. We think that will lead to not only a potential improvement in the service that maybe people who are already claiming these benefits would receive, but actually it will make that people who maybe been discouraged from applying in the past, or maybe been put off from applying in the past, or who maybe have not even thought about applying, are more likely to apply. So we'll see an increase in applications, and also, as David was saying, less of an outflow at the end. That just means that, all else remaining equal, we think that there'll be more people, you'll have a higher caseload of people around adult disability payment relative to the equivalent system that was in place before, and that will lead to higher payments being made by the government, which in turn means that there'll be a higher public spending element of that. If I can go back to my general point about earlier, is that that's part of that's a strategy, that's a policy decision to do it, and you then got all the different. From a public finance point of view, we would say that's a cost, but then there's everything else that comes through about the improvements to, you know, tackling poverty, the improvements to well-being more generally across society in there, but it comes with a public finance cost.
So can I just add that the lower rate of outflows that Graham was talking about, that comes about because of longer periods between caseload reviews and lighter touch reviews. Now, we're not actually seeing those reviews taking place yet. We're just seeing the additional applications for ADP. But as that starts to come through, that'll be another factor that's starting to drive that gap between ADP and PIP numbers. So that will be a factor driving that up more in the future.
Thanks, that's very helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour, who's joining us online. If you'd like to come in, Jeremy.
Yeah, Shelley, thank you. Hopefully you can hear me, and good morning, panel. I'm a wee bit confused about this, because ADP and PIP, the criteria are exactly the same. There's no difference between the two. So surely the awards in England should match the awards in Scotland. So if you apply for PIP in England and you apply for ADP in Scotland, you will, the criteria are the same, so you get the same decision. Or are you noticing different decision making happening north and south of the border?
I think I heard your question there. Just so you're entirely right in that what we're not seeing is that there's a change to the value of the payment or the amount of payments that people are getting. What we're essentially capturing is the fact that we think that because of the different approach to delivering Social Security in Scotland, that will essentially encourage or support more people to apply for the same benefit than would otherwise would have been the case. So things like, you know, promotion campaigns, encouragement to apply, a more accessible and supportive application process will mean that more people are successful in applying. So people, maybe someone who might maybe have started the process and then found the process really quite difficult or quite challenging, and maybe given up on that and not followed through, they'll be more likely to be supported to complete that process in Scotland. Things like, you know, changes to assessments. So we know that people maybe are put off by face-to-face physical assessments, but they're potentially more likely to not be put off if that is not a requirement in there. So essentially what we are thinking is that, and we talk a bit about caseload, where we show the difference between ADP and PIP. We think there'll be an increase in the number of people applying and successfully receiving this benefit relative to what otherwise would have been the case. So it's not that the actual benefit itself is changing, it's just that there'll be a higher caseload of successful people applying and then securing that payment.
Could I just add one point to that? That one interesting thing we've learned through talking to Social Security Scotland is that one of the factors that Graham was referring to about making it easier to apply for benefits is that people can produce a wider range of evidence in support of their claim. And some of the evidence we've got from Social Security Scotland is that people thought that the government already had this information. And so they turn up to apply, assuming the government has all this wide range of information available. And then they find out the government doesn't have that. So they have to go off and acquire that information themselves. But because they've made the initial application, that triggers the onset of the award. And it may be that the award only comes along later, but it is backdated to the date at which they initiated the application. So you might see a timing effect on the payments because of this, but it won't affect the fact that the overall level of payments will be higher.
So it's just one more point as well, and just to say that we've started to get the data through from Social Security Scotland on what's happening with adult disability payment in terms of applications and approval rates. And in our report in figure 5.9, we show that since adult disability payment was launched, if you do sort of on a comparative basis to England and Wales, even though, as we discussed, there's that UK-wide effect, so in England and Wales, applications are increasing. You can see from the launch of ADP, they increase far more quickly in Scotland. That sort of supports our assumptions that we think there will be more applications, and then we followed that through in the data and looking at approved applications as well. And so far we haven't found any evidence in the data that suggests our assumptions that there will be more people relative to PIP. So we're holding on steady on those assumptions at the moment, and as more data becomes available, we'll continue to refine them. But just to say at the moment, sort of those assumptions around how more people will receive adult disability payment than would have received PIP seem to be holding.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful. I'm going to invite Bob Doris in now. Thank you.
Thank you. A brief supplementary on Mr Balfour's question, which I thought was really important, convener, because clearly ADP and PIP are two different things, but they've been run similarly at the moment with the same criteria. I think Professor Roy's outlined why you can still get greater uptake under the same criteria depending on the culture and the systems you put in place to encourage applications. However, once migration of PIP to ADP is complete, mm-hmm. the Scottish Government will be reviewing criteria, including, for example, the 20-metre rule. Yep. And the reason for not doing that just now, Gavina, would be you would have two qualifying households in Scotland, one mm-hmm. assessed under one criteria under PIP and a different one under ADP. But once that's all together under ADP, there'll be a new criteria. Will yourselves have a role to do some modelling work around that mm-hmm. further mm-hmm. to see what the additional benefit would be to disabled households in Scotland, but I suppose what the additional cost would be in budgetary terms? Mm-hmm. Is that something that you'd be expecting to be actively involved in? Mm-hmm.
Yes, so you're right. So essentially, when we are trying to make a judgment about Social Security spending, so something like ADP, essentially the two elements that are the big thing that drive it, aside from things like demographics and the stock of the population, is essentially judgments that we make around eligibility, take-up, successful applications. And that's essentially what we've been talking about so far. The same system, but delivered in quite a different way that we think will lead to an increase in people people successfully claiming these benefits. And then there's the next bit is if in the future policy around ADP was to change, either could be, you're right, you know, about the eligibility for it, or it could be about the value of payment, it could be about the kind of length of payment, all these things. Mm-hmm. Once that starts to change, then we would start to model that as part of the budget process, as part of our policy costings, and we would essentially take the government policy, if it was to be revised on, say, the 20-metre rule, and then we would make an estimate about who would benefit from that, what might that then be in terms of a fiscal implication, and that's where we would come in.
Okay, thanks for not on the record.
Could I just add that it's not our role to make any judgments about the policy objectives and how far this is delivering policy objectives. Our role is simply to assess the fiscal consequences of whatever policies are being implemented. But we will certainly be updating our models and our thinking as soon as the Scottish Government reforms other aspects of the ADB system.
That's just for clarifying, Professor Ulf. Absolutely, again, I would never draw you on the merits of policy intent, but obviously politicians have to make informed decisions on costings, because there's lots of things we'd like to do, but we also have to be able to afford it and budget for it, not just from year to year, but in the longer term, which is why this evidence session is particularly important. Mm-hmm. Can I ask a little bit around baseline data for all of this, I suppose, because the Scottish Fiscal Commission notes the average award level for new applications currently for adult disability payment has not yet stabilised. Mm-hmm. Can I ask by that, do you mean awards that are successful, or do you mean the level of award, mm-hmm. or a combination of both? But more importantly, when would you expect that to stabilise, and would that become more baseline data by which you'd be advising the Scottish Government about modelling work for any future changes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. So one of the things that we're in, and it is a really difficult thing to just kind of try and explain and understand where we are, is that with the rollout of these benefits, we're in essentially a really period where we're a wee bit in the dark, because we don't know what the long-term sustainable trends in these data are, because it's the first time we're doing it. So we are very impatient waiting for the data to come through so we can actually say, are our judgments right or wrong? Where do we need to make the differences? And as Michael was saying, you know, we track, for example, the application rates, and we can then look at them to see how they are doing. We look at changes in, say, inflows and outflows and the like. And one of the ones which is crucial to what we do is this average payment. And once we have a stable average payment, that then becomes fundamental to us in terms of pushing it forward, because we know what the average payment is. If we know what the average inflows and outflows are, then we can be pretty confident in our forecasts. We don't yet have enough time series to be really confident about that average payment. What we know so far from the data is that the average payments that we've been tracking, the actual data of successful payments coming through, has been quite volatile. So I think early on when it was rolled out, we were seeing a significant increase in average payments relative to what had gone before. That's come down a bit, and it's not as high as it had been. When we can speculate about what that might be the case, it might be prioritisation within Social Security Scotland to get to the people who are needing the most support early on, and that means that's why average payment has been higher. It's coming down now, and I think we just need a bit more time to see more data points. Then we can then have a bit more confidence in that average payment. It won't be as volatile as it is
probably
just now.
Guessed my final part of the question. You said a bit more time, Professor Roy. The Scottish Government are committed to reviewing all of this in the round. They can't do that unless they're confident about robust baseline data. Yeah. Quite rightly, you need a bit more time. This committee needs to plan how we wish to scrutinise all of that.
Yeah.
What do you think a bit more time looks like, where that's stabilised and we have that baseline data?
Yeah, I mean, I think this question is how long is a piece of string in many ways. I mean, I think that we are now, as we start to move into year two, year kind of three and four, and move through this, we should have much more data points than we have at the moment. There's obviously been the issue around backlog and things, and actually just working through that, and we see the progress that Social Security of Scotland have made over the last few months in reducing that. And that again is really helpful, because it just gives us more data points coming through of that. I mean, I would think as we move over the next year, then you should start to see that average payment start to stabilise, and at that point then we can start to get more confident. I don't think we'll enact date where we go, now we're confident. It will just be a gradual process of having more data and being clearer.
I apologise, Professor Roy, almost treating you as if you're a politician, which you're absolutely not. But if this was a minister or a cabinet secretary that I'd asked this question to, invariably myself or colleagues would have said, the financial year 24-25, once Social Security Scotland gives outturn figures for all of that, and they can be verified, validated and analysed, are you good to go on this? And if so, what's the timescale around that? Mm-hmm. Because we'd ask that question to the politicians, but the politicians then have to ask yourselves. I feel like we're asking the experts directly.
Yeah. Do you want to come in, Michael?
Yeah. One point I think that'll mean that things are maybe a bit more stable is once the case transfer from DWP, from the PIP cases, is complete. And I think that should be completed in the 24-25 year. So after that, but then obviously there's still the lags that the data is available. So I think Social Security Scotland just published their latest statistics. It was, I think, the same day as the budget on December the 19th they published, so that we've currently got adult disability payment statistics up to the end of October. So they're actually really quite up to date with the sort of caseload and application statistics. So, but then it's it would still be after the end of the 24-25 year, once things have settled down a bit more, with that case transfer complete, which I think is where we maybe expect to be.
Thank you. Can I maybe just add a point here that I think there are different trends going on here. That there's a trend that Graham referred to, where perhaps it was the early cases were the most clear-cut cases where decisions were made, and those awards tend to be the highest awards, which is a factor driving average awards down. We've also got this issue I referred to earlier about lighter touch reviews, longer periods between reviews, and the impact of that on average awards we won't start to see for a while, but that could start to have the opposite effect of driving up average awards if the early awards were high and you're prolonging those high early awards. So there's factors going in different directions here, which makes that's part of the reason why it's hard for us to say exactly when this will stabilise and settle down.
No more questions. That was really helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener. Right, looking at the overall picture and this $1.092 billion, which is more than that's the additional spend that we're having to find. Now, if I'm right in saying roughly half of that is the Scottish Child Payment, which is completely ours because they don't have one in the UK, and then another big chunk is the ADP extra. Is that right? Are there other factors in there as well?
Broadly, at a macro level, so in terms of the chunky numbers, that's pretty accurate. So when we're thinking about what's driving Social Security spending, so what's driving the increase that we're seeing over the next few years, there's the chunk of stuff that we've spoken about already, which is trends at the UK level, so inflation and the big rise across the UK of people inflowing into disability payments through linked to mental health, legacies of COVID and the like, but that's all matched by the BGA, so that drives the increase in Social Security spending, but there's an inflow in funding. So then we're left with what's the bit of the budget that is not matched by an inflow in BGA funding. And roughly speaking, you're right. You know, there's a chunk of things which is there is no equivalent funding flowing in from the rest of the UK, and that's things like the Scottish Child Payment, which is unique to Scotland, and there isn't an equivalent benefit in the rest of the UK. And that's roughly, the rule of thumb, it's roughly about half of the funding differential. And then there's the remainder, which is the judgments we've just spoken about with Deputy Convener there about the additional approach that's being taken in Scotland to deliver equivalent benefits in the rest of the UK, and that is leading to the higher inflow, and that's the remaining half in there. And the two big chunky bits in there are Scottish Child Payment in the first of these, and then Adult Disability Payment in the second part. There are some smaller elements in there, so things like Child Disability Payments, which we think will run ahead of the BGA, which again is added in. Into that, and then there's some other smaller elements around on the there isn't equivalent BGE on things like discretion housing payments, so the stuff around bedroom tax, carers allowance supplement, which again adds a small amount of money into there, but they are typically in the margin of about 100 million rather than the 500 million or so from the Scottish Child Payment.
So they're kind of rolled into the Barnett formula. They're not specifically.
So some of them are rolled in. We separate this out into the maybe if you can find the table, Michael. But we separate it out. There's some Social Security payments that have no equivalent funding at all, whether BGA or Barnett, things like the Scottish Child Payment. There are some things where there are some elements that are rolled into the block grant, but they're very small in the scheme of things. So I think they're about 100 million overall. And then there's the other bits which are matched by a BGA, which are the is a net position. And so there's three combinations. So we talk figure 5.8, we kind of separate out the three different elements into there to come up to your one point one billion. About 368 of that is the net position. 600 million is essentially these new social security payments that don't have an equivalent BGA, so child payment, and about 100 million from these other things, which are wrapped. Some of them are wrapped up in terms of Barnett.
Okay, so I mean, and you're assuming, I think, as you've said to previous questions, that there's no change in policy. So both the UK carries on with its policy and Scotland carries on with its policy.
Yeah.
I mean, presumably our figures could be affected by either of these changing. If the UK government changes, then we'll have more extra. Yeah. Is that right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, one thing I would say is, in terms of policy, in terms of like payments, etc., it is a policy to implement quite a different system in Scotland to encourage take up and to support people into it. So it is a discretionary policy decision by the Scottish Government to implement a different type of social security system, even if the payments and eligibility are not changing. It still is a different policy because you're going to get more inflows into
that. OK, so you've got UK policy and Scottish policy, but you're assuming that both of them kind of carry on
as
they are.
Exactly, yeah. So and you can get, this is where in time, if you start to have changes in policy at a UK level, that will feed through to potentially to the BGA. So again, you know, changes to eligibility for universal credit would potentially have a knock-on implication in terms of eligibility to the Scottish Child Payment. If the UK government, for example, were to reform PIP in the future, that would then have an implication in terms of the BGA, which would then feed through to how much funding was flowing into the budget. So it wouldn't, if the UK was to change PIP, ADP policy wouldn't change automatically. The funding might change, well, the funding would change into the overall budget in terms of the BGA, but it would then be a Scottish Government decision about how they may respond or not respond in ADP.
Yeah, and I mean, it's often said that both of these, both for UK Government and Scottish Government, this is a demand-led area and we really cannot control it very much.
So you can... Yeah, I mean, I'll maybe let David come in a second. You can control it in the sense of what you do is you set the policy, you set eligibility and you set criteria, and then essentially you then rely on essentially the demand of people flowing into these payments. Clearly, you can then ex post start to change eligibility and payments if you wanted to. But once you set a policy, then essentially for the next year and the next month, you're then essentially relying on take-up of these benefits. And that's quite different from traditional devolved spending, such as health, where you choose, I'm going to give X amount of money to this health board, and it's X amount of money that flows to that health board. Here, what you do is you set criteria and eligibility, and then you essentially let demand of people flowing into that. And that's why it's quite a different a way of managing the public finances and spending relative to other normal devolved expenditures.
Professor Alv?
Yes, just to elaborate on that point, that what happens in other areas of spending like health and education is the Scottish Government and the Parliament approve overall levels of funding. Other people then split that down into, say, funding for universities, funding for schools, and then every university and school gets a budget out of that, and they decide how that's going to be spent, whether they fill a post by appointing a geography teacher or a PE teacher. So the real implications of that are felt at the end of a chain of decisions by a lot of individuals. Parliament just sets an overall number, and the implications flow through at a lower level. It's almost the other way around with Social Security. Mm-hmm. You set the eligibility criteria. Social Security Scotland interprets those eligibility criteria to say who's going to get the awards. You set the amount. You set what evidence people have to provide in order to get the award. And then that all gets translated into numbers, an overall spending number that emerges from a whole series of decisions. You don't choose that spending number. Mm-hmm. That emerges from a lot of decisions by other people. Now, you can control that because you can change some of the initial decisions, but you're changing the things that are really conspicuous to individuals. You're saying, we're changing your eligibility criteria, we're changing the amount of money you're going to get, we're changing this aspect of how you can apply. So the implications for individuals are much more immediate when you're trying to control Social Security, whereas if you just change health spending, people say, okay, health has been cut, but they don't quite see the implications for their own GP visits for quite a while from that. So yes, it can be controlled, but politically I think it's a different set of issues you're facing because of the direction of flow between the spending money and the ultimate implications.
Okay, well, I certainly find that helpful personally, that to have it laid out in that kind of way. And the final point I was going to make, so we had that split, we looked at the split of the 109.2 million. Now, going forward, that split is kind of changing a bit, am I right in saying? So, whereas Scottish Child Payments are about half at the moment, it wouldn't be half going forward. Can you explain why that is the case?
So, essentially, as you move towards the end of the forecast horizon, that's where we think that the effects, particularly the different benefits in Scotland and the different inflows, that's where they start to have a gradually greater impact as the applications and caseloads increase. And that's why, as a proportion of that kind of gap, you see the gap in the block grant adjustment taking up a slightly bigger share on that. Because what we essentially assume on Scottish Child Payment is essentially numbers broadly remain relatively flat, relatively stable going forward, but then and the payment is uprated by inflation. Whereas we think that if you look at things like the disability payments, adult disability, child disability, you have a growth in these numbers, which leads to the higher levels of expenditure on that.
Okay. Okay, thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. And I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thanks.
Sorry, Convener, I don't have any... Sorry, Convener, I don't have a supplementary at this point.
Okay, I believe there was a question, I think. Was it question 7, I believe, Jeremy?
Oh, my apologies, Convener. I don't have that in front of me. I wonder if someone else can take that.
Yeah, that's okay. I'm going to invite Bob Doris in. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I know what it was the Convener was hoping to get on the record from the Fiscal Commission, so maybe ask that and then roll together my other question, if that's okay. So by 2019, the Scottish Government is expected to spend around £1.5 billion more on Social Security than it receives in funding through the block grant adjustment. This is all forecast, of course, based on all the best evidence you can get. How uncertain is that figure?
Yeah. I think there are two different aspects. This builds on a bit of the conversation I had with Mr. Mason there. There's an element of the spending around things like Scottish Child Payment, which we can be relatively confident, aside from any future policy changes, in the amount of spending that will take in the future, and then therefore that relative that doesn't have an equivalent BGA, because that is largely as a benefit around number of children who are eligible via universal credit. So it's a relatively straightforward element to forecast. Where there's a greater uncertainty and where there's the greater potential variability is in the second element of the benefit, the Social Security funding differential we're talking about, which is where the Scottish Government is implementing a new approach to, crucially in terms of adult disability payment. And that's where there's the greatest uncertainty around that. We've made judgments, I think we started making these judgments in May 2022 for the first time, where we said, look, we think that this different approach will lead to a difference in funding. I think we're very confident, and if you look at the data so far, that there will be a gap relative to the funding flowing in. And in many ways, that is entirely what you'd expect. You wouldn't be expecting to implement a different system that was designed to encourage and support more people to claim these benefits and to change the system and to make it more supportive, and then not expect more people to be successful in applying. So there will be a gap. The uncertainty essentially comes around how big could that gap be, and that's the bit where there's an uncertainty. So it's essentially half of that funding gap is where there's an uncertainty. There will be a gap. How big that uncertainty is the bit, again, back to your earlier question. We just need a bit more data to wait and see whether that comes through. As Michael said, we look at all these things as we go. We thought there would be a spike when ADP was introduced. That happened. We thought there'd be higher levels of ADP relative to PIP after that spike, once those the national launch. That's happened. So the data that we're seeing is consistent with our judgment calls. We just need to wait to see actually what the exact number is to see whether or not these specific numbers need to be revised or not.
Does the Fiscal Commission build in almost like a tolerance level in relation to that 1.5 billion? Because I absolutely get it.
Yeah.
Your forecast could be dramatically blown off course by a significant policy change at either a UK or a Scottish level, yeah, or an unforeseen event. Mm-hmm. Does the Fiscal Commission build in, even if this is a thing, because this is not my area,
yeah,
do they build in like a 5% tolerance, a 10% tolerance? So would you say our forecast is 1.5%, but that could be 10% greater or 10% lower based on our the range,
yeah,
of judgments, and if so, what is the tolerance level, yeah, around that?
So we don't do a specific tolerance of saying 5%, 10%, in part because the nature of what we're tasked to do is to come up with a specific number to help the government set their budget. What we do though is that through both our reports, but also our forecast evaluation report, which is a crucial bit that comes out every year where we look back, that's where we unpick all the different elements. So we say this is essentially the element we think will come through more successful applications. This is the thing that will come through terminal illness. This is the thing, the increase that will come through average payment. So you can essentially do that sort of work yourself. Ditto as well, we then look back at actually where have things changed and where might be the variation in that. So we don't do a specific, here's a rule of thumb to do, but we kind of work, we show our working so anyone can look at the potential level of uncertainty there.
Okay. Sorry, just one point to come in on.
I think just to pick up on when we've added in, you know, forecasts for the different approach used compared for the disability benefits. I think we started to do that in the run-up to May 2022, but it was in May 2022 that we did it first for all benefits that included the pensioner ones as well as the working age adult one. But the main, I think, the first time we did it in full for adult disability payment was in August 2021, where we provided quite a lot of information there, along the lines Graham was talking about the different breakdowns.
Okay, thank you.
Could I just add that when we first produced our forecasts for ADP, there were 12 different areas of reform that the Scottish Government had introduced into how ADP was going to be delivered. And we had to make, because there was no evidence at all, we had to make judgments on each of those 12 elements. Now, the judgments we made on the things that have come to pass so far, as Graham said, we can't say our judgments were definitely correct, apart from terminal illness, we haven't seen anything that says they were very far out. What we haven't yet seen are the implications of our judgments about lighter touch case reviews, longer periods between case reviews. The implications of that are still dependent on our initial judgments that we made 2 or 3 years ago. So that is where the area of uncertainty still remains. It's a judgment-based forecast. But that doesn't mean we just made the numbers up. That was based on lots of discussions with experts and other people in this area, which is why I think some of our earlier judgments have turned out not to be very far off the mark.
I love that quote, Professor Ulf. We don't just make the numbers up. I'm glad you put that on the record. Convener, I had another question, as you know, but you have to manage the time.
Yeah,
don't come in at the end
conscious of that.
If there's time
I think
at the
you
end,
kind
perhaps.
Of actually touched yeah. upon Rosie's next question yeah. as well. But if you would still like to come in, Rose.
I would, yeah, he keeps doing this to me. No, because the two do follow on, and I was very interested in forecast error. And it very much touches on that, what you've said, and I do appreciate the information you've given me. But we're looking at 3% or 127 million, as per the information you've given us. Now, 3%, as alluded to before, when you're talking about as time goes on and the bill increases, therefore a 3% variance becomes a lot of money. Do you think that 3% error is what we will continue to expect? Because we really need to have a plus or minus figure in our thought processes as to how we look at budget forecasting moving forward.
Yeah. So the 3% figure relates to 22-23, and the one thing that drove that to be slightly potentially higher than you would think is that when we talk about error, we talk about the difference between what we said at the time of the budget and then actually what transpired. That can change for error in terms of our forecasting, but can also change for error because policy changed. And that was one of the big drivers about why that happened in 22-23. So for this year, so 23-24, we've not had that same in-year policy changes, and we also haven't had the legacy effects of COVID. So we think that error will, that, you know, at this moment in time, touch wood, that error will be smaller this year than it was then. The broader question, though, you're saying is that, and one of the things I think we have to factor in, and you know, in time we will get a better time series about the average error and the average, you know, forecast error that goes in there. Again, we've just got to get more data points. We've got 3% for 22-23. We'll soon have the number for 23-24, and that gives us another data point that we can look at and interrogate. One thing I would say more broadly, though, is that, and this is a fundamental change with devolution, and it's the same conversation we have with the Finance Committee on tax, this is a fundamental difference in the way that the Scottish budget now operates. In the olden days, you had Barnett, you got that money, and then you spent it on devolved elements of spending. You now have a forecast for income tax that will change and be volatile, and the government have to manage that. With Social Security, it's exactly the same. We make a forecast, but it's volatile, and government has to manage that risk. To the extent that the risks are shared with the UK, the BGA will protect. If there's any differences in these risks between Scotland and the rest of the UK, then that will now be all on the Scottish budget. And that's just the nature, the really difficult and the change in the way the Scottish budget is now going to work.
Okay, so just make sure I've got this correct in my mind. So for every variance that the Scottish Government puts forward as far as policy is concerned and the changes that they want to adapt, the insecurities that follow on from that will mean that there could be there needs to be a recognisance of that as far as the budget process is concerned. And we need to be aware that that will have an additional effect based on their policy decisions.
Yeah. So essentially there's two big risks. There's the risk of no differences in policy and Scotland just being different from the rest of the UK. And there's a second bit, which is where the differences of the policy choices might lead to their own risks in terms of how they might be. And that would be that would come through as well.
That's excellent. Thank you very much indeed.
I'm going to bring in Paul, but before I do, I've got a quick question, and please indulge me here, and it's more a technical question in relation to the papers that you provided us with, and it's the IFRS 16. And I'm just, if you could just, as I say, it mentions about it's being used progressively within the public sector at the moment. It's a new standard that's obviously come in terms of the lease and impacts on capital. But what it states, and if just for the benefit of myself and the rest of us here, if you could just put it in layman's terms about how it impacts on the resource compared to and it increases the capital.
Yeah. So the IFRS is largely a technical accounting definition of the budgets and where things score and where things are reported in there. It doesn't change actual it's not changing the actual kind of outflow of what the government is spending and actual spend in that regard. It's just, it's largely a way of reporting it. And it's essentially the change is bringing the Scottish government budgets in line with good process for how budgets are reported. So we talk a bit about how this is how, if you looked at it through the with the new IFRS system, these are the numbers here. This is how it would look if you're looking at the old system. But it doesn't actually change the actual spend. It's just how it's all how it's reported.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much for that. And now I'm going to bring in Paul O'Kane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'm interested to understand more about policy costings, both in terms of, I think, new policies that will come in this year. But I think my first kind of question would be about whether there are delays to new benefits, the impact that that has in terms of forecasting. So we know, for example, that the delay of carer support payment from spring to autumn, mm-hmm. It has been, you know, widely discussed, and we've spoken about it in this committee. I just wonder to what extent that has an impact in terms of the forecast.
Yeah. So in the part in terms of the totality of spend, it doesn't impact because everything is backdated. Where it may have an impact at the margin would be as if it's impacting changing year on year. So if you had people who were not, say, receiving a payment in 23-24, but they got it in 24-25 and it was backdated, and that would obviously uplift the expenditure in the year it was taking place. The one thing I would caution and just say in that is that we don't think at this stage, and we thought about this, it's having a material impact on our forecasts in terms of the public finances, because you're dealing with a relatively small number of like inflows rather than the totality of there, and it's a small percentage. So it, given that it's a relatively small number of a much bigger number that drives the overall totality, it doesn't really have an impact on our forecast. And also as well, particularly we've seen over the last year, within the last financial year, we've seen quite a drop in that, which in turn means that from a public finance point of view, it doesn't really have a material impact on our forecasts.
Okay, that's helpful. And then I think in terms of benefits coming on stream this year, obviously there's a degree of uncertainty, particularly around things like pension age disability payment to replace attendance allowance. Mm-hmm. And I think you have said that costings remain highly uncertain in that space. So I wonder to what extent your experience of forecasting other disability payments have informed your costings and that assessment of pension age disability payment.
Yeah. I mean, Michael, I don't know if you want to maybe come in on just some of the detail about how the judgments we then use on things like CDP and ADP and the data we track feeds through into that, but maybe a bit about the actual process we go through about costing.
Yeah. So with pension age disability payment, our start point is attendance allowance, the benefit it's replacing, and then it's looking at, we forecast based on the caseload, so the number of people getting the benefit and then the average amount that each person gets. And then when looking across the changes that have been made about sort of promoting the benefit and encouraging more people to make applications, we think that that will have an effect on the number of new people flowing into it. So then in our models, we sort of have ways of forecasting the what we call monthly inflows, which are the new people starting each month, and make adjustments upwards to reflect what our judgment is on those increases. And it's really helpful that you're mentioning CDP and ADP in that context, because I think we made similar judgments for CDP and ADP, and they're the ones that we've been starting to get the data through to sort of verify those judgments. And so far, as I say, we haven't seen evidence that we need to change those judgments for CDP and ADP. So at the moment, we think we're quite happy to make similar judgments for PADP, even though the client group's quite different, because it's a pension age client group. We still think that relative to attendance allowance, just because of, as I said, the promotion and the help that people might have applying, that there will be more applications and more successful people receiving the benefit compared to had attendance allowance continued. And that then leads to sort of a gap versus what we expect the BGA funding to be.
I wonder if, just briefly, Convener, just on that point about EDP and understanding the uptake, I suppose, and the increase in people receiving that benefit. I mean, you say that analysis is underway or is being done. Is that something you would intend to share more widely in terms of to inform this committee's work?
Yeah.
So we've in the report, we've already started to sort of look at that and talk in a bit more detail about that. And figure 5.9 we show it in terms of applications, but obviously that's the first stage in the process. Yeah. Then further down the line, and because of the time of processing. So I think, yeah, it's this picture that we plan to continue to build up in future reports, and certainly in May, it's one that I think we'll definitely build on more.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite... I believe Marie McNair wants to come in, and then I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Actually, thanks for your indulgence. I'd previously asked the Fiscal about difference a more generous and quicker approach to terminal illness is making to the Scottish budget, and obviously it's really important we get this right for this particular claimant. You touched on that in your opening speech. Do you have any further observations that you can bring to the committee for us? Just, I'm really interested in that part.
Yeah, I mean, Michael, maybe we want to go into some of the detail around that. The broader point about that I was making around terminal illness is that we make one of the big things that we make an assessment about how that about the number of claimants that might be coming through for terminal illness, and we had an assessment in there about what we thought might be the number of people coming through on that, and then looking at the data so far that we're getting from Social Security Scotland, we think that our judgment was higher than has actually flown through. So we've adjusted our number accordingly for that, and that then feeds through to our forecast in there. I don't know if you want to explain a bit about what data it is we're tracking and that shows that.
Yeah, so in published statistics, we can see the number coming through under the special rules for terminal illness, and as Graham says, it's below the level that we'd had in our forecast previously. So, but we still think, sort of based on the wider evidence, that the level that we thought it would get to by the end of the forecast will be the same. It's just the rate that it will get there will be a bit slower. It will just take a bit longer to build up. So that means that in our forecast for 2024-25, that reduction and adjustment in the profile has reduced the forecast by 27 million, say, for 2024-25. But then that sort of reduction reduces... If that makes sense in later years, so then it gradually builds up.
Are you aware of any reasons why that's the case? Is it the promotion of it, or
it could be? This is sort of more on the speculating side. It's difficult to find any hard data on it, but it could be just the way that it's interacting with people applying through the normal rules, and whether people at the moment who might have become eligible under the terminal illness rules actually qualified under normal rules earlier. So it's not sort of a separate group of people coming in. It does interact with the rest of the caseload. So it's an area that we'll continue to look at to try and understand that. But I think, it's difficult to try and see there's any specific reason at the moment.
Thank you much, Mrs. Convener. Cheers.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in, and I think this will be our very last question for you. So thank you very much.
It may be two questions. I just wonder if I could follow that up slightly by asking, is the data you're getting from Social Security Scotland sufficient, and are there areas you think we should be recording that we haven't recorded as yet?
When we spoke to the committee, I think maybe 18 months ago, we were saying we really needed much more data from Social Security Scotland, we had some concerns about our ability to do the forecast. I should say, and it's good to put on the record, is that we have, the amount of data and support we receive from Social Security Scotland is excellent, and we've had a lot of the data that we're now seeing. And as coming back to the question from Bob Doris about, we're now getting data points coming in, we're now tracking applications, we're now tracking average payments. We just need to wait a bit longer for that. So we're getting a lot of that data from Social Security Scotland. We also get, which is again really helpful, is lots of really useful intelligence from Social Security Scotland. So they're able to tell us about, what's happening to backlog, what they're seeing in terms of applications, what they're doing around promotion, etc. And that, again, is really helpful for us because it then means that we can then take judgments about where we are on that. I don't know if there's anything specific, Michael, that we're still waiting on.
No, I think it's more looking sort of to the next benefits that are sort of being launched, like so in particular, I think next one, well, it's just the pilot's just started as care support payment. I think we're keen that obviously and hopefully that they will then be able to provide the data on that in a timely manner. And then following that, it's PADP as well. So I think it's just in future. And the one area I think where we do mention an adult disability payment is around the award review data. But I think that's because it's that part of the process is sort of in still quite the early stages. But we're hopeful that we might have data on that to inform the next forecast, which we expect to be in May. Mm.
Thank you. If I can just go on to my final question. What are the main elements of uncertainty in the costs for pension age disability payment and pension age winter keeping payment? And can I just put on record as well that I am in receipt of a higher rate of PIP, just for the record. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. So on the pension age winter heating payment, again, that's probably one of the ones where there's much less uncertainty because it's largely just demographics. It's largely the number of people who are eligible, and because it's kind of universal, it's just what the forecast is, how many people are eligible. That's basically it. There's more uncertainty around the pension age disability payment because, as Michael said, we've got a judgment about what might be uptake, what might be the successful applications in there. Again, avoiding the temptation to put a specific number on it, it's probably likely to be less uncertain than ADP and child disability payment because of the nature of the demographics that we have in that. There's a judgment that we've made in there, but it's probably likely to be less uncertain than what we've done for some of the other benefits.
Thank you.
Okay. Unless anyone else wants to come in, then that actually concludes our evidence session and our public business for today. Can I just say thank you very much? And several of the committee are actually going to visit Social Security on Monday in Dundee. So I feel that we're definitely armed with a lot more information to ask pertinent questions anyway. So thank you very much. And thanks again for your attendance here today. We'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. So thank you.